unsure.
Unsure.
Kind of short, but not really.
You don't have to know.
That's the good news. Because in nursing, you can do anything. So when I first graduated, I went to work at a nursing home, partially because that was a full-time opening. Maybe not. I thought that was kind of what I wanted to do, testing the waters. There's lots of people that started on med-surg, end up in ER, start on OB, end up in OR. You don't have to know. So I don't know is a real option. But what you're going to know is that in every scenario, no matter where you're working, home care, in a hospital, in a clinic, for an insurance company, you're going to run into mental health. An OR nurse sees anxiety all day long. Who's ever anxious to go into surgery? Everybody. An OB nurse deals with all kinds of family dynamics. Med-surg, ER, ICU, if you want to go on as an NP, no matter where you go. Teaching deals with lots of anxiety before exams, right? Doesn't matter where you go, you're going to make contact with mental health somewhere. Now, mental health is hard because who's ever been sad? Who's ever been happy? Who's ever had a lot of energy? Who's ever been, you know, really particular about the way they study? Everybody has symptoms of mental health. Everybody. It's only when it inhibits functioning that we can diagnose it, that we start treating. So it means that you can't go to school, you can't go to work, you can't deal with family, you can't go to obligations. So everybody has some mental health. There's a mental health wellness, and there's a mental health dysfunction. So it doesn't matter if it's good or bad, mental health is there. So what do you guys know about verbal de-escalation? Okay. What do you, if you were to approach somebody who's sitting there going, I'm so mad at you right now, how would you do it? Stay calm. You could make a good sentence. Tell me more, right? Open-ended questions and all of that. So I know you guys have gone through therapeutic communication and how to build rapport. So I'm just gonna add to that a little bit with how to de-escalate someone who's agitated. Whether it's anxiety, anger, no matter the reason, because that is the part that scares every nurse. How many of you were going to clinical going, a good job? Were you scared to walk into the psych unit? Absolutely. Because if you watch movies, like One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest and Girl Interrupted, that's what it is. It's scary. It doesn't have to be that way. You can prevent those things from happening. So I'm going to tell you how. So why? Okay, I'm just kidding. So why do we need to do this? So it doesn't matter where your patient's coming in, the clinic, the classroom, the hospital, out in the community. People with mental health disorders are coming in and they're already at the worst time of their life. They are vulnerable. They feel the stigma, right? No one wants to get care because mental health doesn't exist. They feel that stigma already, even walking up to the ER door. So they're already 10 times more frustrated than they should be. Everyone who goes to the ER has to wait. Hopefully not, but sometimes that happens. So they're afraid of the weight. They're afraid of people going, will you just run it off? You know, just get outside, enjoy the sunshine, it'll be fine. Oh no, you're just worried about this exam, it'll be fine, right? A lot of people have negative attitudes. And they fear that they're gonna be looked down upon, that they're going to be second class citizen or locked up in a room or any of the things that can go through, right? So, walking into the ER, they are already petrified. Now, I don't know about you, but when I'm anxious or afraid of something, I'm not my best self. I flub up my words. I have a hard time. These people are already there. So that's why we need to make sure we're doing it right. Why did you guys information about walking in the psych unit. What did you think?
Unpredictable behavior.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Anybody else? Could be physical violence. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So, in some very emotional cases, because you're hearing the worst of their life, right? Carol, so you just joined us on the site. Did you have any apprehension about coming to work as a nurse? Comfortable thing. Okay. And sometimes just experiencing it and realizing that it's leather furniture and big screen TVs.
Can I add something?
Sure.
For me, it was realizing that these individuals are just like individuals, but they just not want to be in this. It could be anybody else.
Absolutely.
So,
we always tell the patients that we are one crisis away from being the next. Doesn't mean that we are any better. To be honest, psych nurses, when we choose our group therapies for the day, when we decide what we're going to teach the patients, probably is something that we're struggling with right now. If I'm in a bad mood, you bet I'm doing gratitude for group. If I'm having a hard time communicating something I need to say, I'm doing communication because I learn from that. So nurses sometimes don't want to come to site and like, oh, I don't know. It's because they don't feel prepared. It's because they think they're going to get attacked or there's not enough staff, right? Oh, there's not enough people here to keep me safe. It's those personal biases that even though we try not to happen, society says, how many people have heard, oh, Mother Nature's so bipolar. Like, why are we using that word? It's not even the correct use of it. But anyway. And then you want to give everything you can to that patient, but you have four other patients, and someone's probably close to dying, and you're trying to balance that as well. So that leads to that kind of poor treatment or being more erect. So I'm going to tell you the 10 commandments of dealing with difficult patients, any patient. And it's not just me talking. This is from the AAPP, which is the American Association of Nurses and Psychiatrists. So this is the beta project, and they created this and tested this, and I'll show you the results of it. So commandment one is environment, right? So if I came into your room, and this is a really big patient room, and stood there like this, what are you thinking? I'm not getting out of here. If I was standing in the doorway and the fire alarm went off, how bad would your anxiety be right now? You block an egress. You want to be the closest person to the door. You never go beyond the patient into the room, because if something happens, you want to be the first one out. But you can't block the exit, because that alone is going to increase anxiety. Now, some of you experienced Dr. Overton, right? And he came over to you and stood right here. And was that intimidating? Yeah. You can't be too close. You can't get right in their face. You can't be, it's okay. You can't be so close. You gotta give them some space. Now, I have a pretty big bubble. The kids only laugh at me because I'm like, no, I don't do comments about big news. I have a big bubble. Mm-hmm. How close is too close? I'm like, well, okay, that answers. So it depends on the person, but there is, and we'll get into that, there is an appropriate distance. But it varies. Now, appropriate distance with someone who needs comforting is gonna be a whole lot different than someone who's paranoid. Someone who's paranoid, you need to back away a little bit more. You need to give them reactionary room. So if they're coming at you, you have time to sidestep, to get away, right? Now, those who went to Acadia, do they still teach? Like Moab and go over that stuff? Okay, so you'll know some of this. The other thing is decreasing stimulation, right? So if you want someone to be calm, blasting music, keeping the lights on bright, and having 52 people in the room, isn't gonna work. What else about environment could you make to be more common? The temperature, they shouldn't be too hot or too cold. No, they shouldn't have to do this. But they also shouldn't feel like they have to drink the coffee. So anything about environment that makes it more comfortable for you, makes it more comfortable for them. Commandment two. You will use a common tone. So number one, stay calm, right? Calm and in control. It doesn't mean that you're gonna get, because those situations are tough. When someone is being aggressive, when someone is threatening, everybody's adrenaline's up and everybody's jumping up and down and like, oh, what are we gonna do? That's the worst thing you can do. Best thing you can do is to stay calm. Be that soft-spoken person. Who very normally interacts, right? Because these patients can sense when you're afraid. Just like you can sense that they're afraid. They can sense that you're uncomfortable, that you don't want to be there. And it's all through communication, nonverbal and verbal. So it's normal eye contact. It's hard sometimes. Did you need anything? I'm not looking at them. They know that. And they suddenly go, she doesn't care for me. She doesn't want me here. She's not going to help me. And show empathy. What does empathy mean? Yes. Putting yourself in that person's shoes and thinking, you know what? They've been through a lot in their life. And you know what? They're scared mentally. It's hard. And they're in a vulnerable place. And I'm going to help them. Now, I work with kids and parents a lot. And so I always use this ladder. If you've got a kid and parent fighting, the kid's like, oh, you're gonna give me a curfew, you're gonna take away my phone, and da 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 da, right? How does the parent respond? How should the parent respond? Calm. How do parents sometimes respond out of frustration? Right. And so they one-up them and try to like talk over them. And then the kid one-ups, and then the adult one-ups, and we go all the way up the ladder until it's full. So when people go up, you go down. If people are raising their voice, you lower yours. If people are standing up, you get smaller. You bring them where you want them to go. So if you match them, you just go right over the edge. You have to bring them down. And so you need to role model that for them. And that's by being calm, soft-spoken, normal, and acting like it's not bothering them, what they're doing. Now, if you're walking in, you're the nurse coming on shift, this patient's in the ER, and you took a report, might have been bedside reporting, who knows? You still need to go in and explain yourself. Because have you ever heard from different people in the hospital that are like, person came in and scrubbed, I don't know if it was the doctor, the nurse, the housekeeper, or the guy here. You have to go in and explain yourself. You have to go in and explain what your role is, who you are, what you can do for them. They need to know that part. So, it's all about how you introduce yourself. So if you walk in there confident, and you go in and say, hi, my name is Melissa, how are you? Good. You looked at me, and I was looking at your eyes. If I walked walked up and said, "Hi, how are you?" That's a million. So when you shake hands, you're going to be, you can't be like, but you're going to enter in, look at them, make eye contact, and establish a relationship. You're going to tell them what you're there for. "I'm the med manager. I'm the therapist. I'm your nurse today. I'll be here until 7, right? Reassure them that everything's okay and that you know what's going on. Biggest thing, it is we, not you. We are going to work together. We are going to get you feeling better. You are part of the team. You're not the provider. You're not the nurse. They're the patient. You're going to be even playing field. You are a team together." Now then, your shift goes along, and you interact with them again. You've introduced yourself. They know what you're there for. Cool. So what is good communication look like? Yes and no? No. Open it. Give them the chance to share. Especially with kids, sometimes you have to repeat yourself and repeat yourself and repeat yourself because they didn't hear it the first time. Because there's a lot going on in their mind right now. There's a lot of stuff at home going on, at school going on. You have to repeat yourself as to what you want, and you have to not get frustrated. When you're trying to talk to them and you say so-and-so, make sure you get their eyes. We tell the kids, like, "Let me see your eyes, let me see your ears." We do that in classrooms to make sure they're listening. With adults, "Hey, look at me just so I know that you're listening. You know, I just want to make sure that I have your full attention." Then after you teach them something, what do? Do you just leave it there and hope they got it? Right. Clarify what you said, repeat what you said, what's your understanding, in your own words, what's your understanding. Teach that. Go ahead and teach me about that now. So this is your new medication. This is what it does. This is, now, if you were teaching someone else about it, what would you say? Asking them to be the teacher. Now, in every difficult situation, you want to put one communicator. Because if you're in a threatening situation, and there's 15 people talking to the patient at one time, put your hand down. Go over here. Take this med. Everybody's barking orders. That's a whole lot of stimulation. So one communicator, you appoint that person, and as a team, we decide who that's going to be. Now, it's a long 12-hour shift. And so you might get frustrated. You might start getting snappy. What do you do? Tag out. And so you communicate and say, "Carol, I need to step away for a minute. Can you be the communicator for me?" And so then it's just one person talking. It's one person trying to get the rapport and relationship with the patient, not 15. And that really helps to de-escalate when you send one person. So verbal communication, that's calm, reassuring voice. You think some of this is common sense, but you'd be surprised. Have you guys taken your HESI yet? Okay, you'll be surprised at how much this comes up on the HESI. Communicating at their level. If you're working with a kid, I'm not doing this over them. I'm getting down. Right, you scoop down, but you make sure that you're not like sitting on the floor and take it up. Because if it takes a while to get up, and they're mad, that's what your problem. So you need to be able to bounce up. Sometimes that's easier said than done. If you're working with a developmentally disabled adult, you're not going to start spouting off big words that they're not going to understand, and then they're just going to get frustrated. You have to talk to your audience. You have to be where they're at. Meet them where they're at. Obviously, respect, that's kind of common sense, right? But we have to remind ourselves that every now and again. Even though you're part of the team, you're in control. Again, it's the we collective rather than you. And then if you don't think they quite understand, ask them to kind of clarify. What are you taking from this? What are you getting from this? Open-ended, so no yes and no's. You wanna try to get a response out of them, right? If they say, just like Dr. shows that I care about them. It shows that I want to know about that. Especially if it means suicidal, homicidal threats. You know, if they're giving you, dropping hints at things like that, like Dr. Irwin said, you need to ask about it. You need to assess that. You need to not just like, oh, head in the sand, can see that. You have to go there. And it's not comfortable, but it gets easier. Now, isolating the problem from the individual, what does that mean? Yes. An APA, everybody loves APA, right? They're big on that. It's not the alcoholic, it's the person with an alcohol use disorder. It's not the schizophrenic, it's the person with schizophrenia. You know that their problem and disease process is different from them. They weren't always like this, right? They're not always like this. So if you have someone really agitated in your ear, they're not always like this. And remember that. So they're going to be angry. And they're going to be, the last time I was here, someone didn't give me the meds I wanted. Deflect. Right? We're going to push that and be like, well, let's see what we can do for you today. And push that to the past and try to let them know, like, today's new. A new person, we're going to get through this together. Now, y'all have those people who are railroaders, right? You know what I mean by railroaders? So that's the person in group therapy that talks and talks and talks and talks and talks, and you can't stop. How do you stop them? What works?
Thank them.
Right?
Thank you.
Yes, good one. Thanks for sharing about that. Now we're going to move. You can take control. You can stop by saying a name. Hey. And you get their attention. Just like kids, right? If they're doing something on the playground, what do you do? Susie! Stop. You get their attention. Sometimes it's by thanking them or, you know, well, what I'm hearing is, and then you keep going. Those are difficult people to deal with. To get an edge in because you have 500 patients and you've got to keep going, but you want to make sure that you're not being rude. Now, you have someone really agitated and they're bouncing up and down and they're in the office and what do you do with them? They're not going to sit on your couch. They're moving around. Bring them, have them do something. Go for a walk. Walk and talk. Have them help you with something. Like, hey, I gotta go bring this laundry over here. Do you want to help me grabbing it? Don't do it with someone who's gonna chuck it at your head. But have them help you. Have them engage in something. So I see anywhere from 4 to 90 in my office. And on every table in my office, I have fidgets. I have a fidget spinner, I have tangles, I have squishy ball, I have toys everywhere. And the adults come in and they say, oh, that's nice, you must see kids. You have all kinds of toys. It's the adults who play with them most. Because if I were to sit you down and sitting straight with you and tell me about trauma, but if you get them doing something else, so kids playing with Play-Doh or adults gardening, we bring them outside the garden, and then they spill or walk or they need to be focused on something to let the wall down. So get them involved in something. And that's all too often we're trying to like, oh, don't give them anything. Let them have something that they can do that's safe so you can get them talking. Now what's the substitution technique? So when you're working with somebody and they ask you for something, so patient asks for a pen. Well, I don't know about you, but a lot of the pens, you can take it apart, there's springs, there's metal, there's like the risk of harming themselves. Ugh, I don't feel comfortable with that. Hey, I can't give you a pen, but how about a colored pencil? Would that work? Do some problem solving. Give them something that gets the job done, that you feel comfortable. And you can do that in any scenario. Well, I can't give you that pain med right now, it's not time, but I do have Tylenol. Would you like to try, maybe we can put the Tylenol with the cold pack? We do it all the time, right? So it's problem solving with them, not that you're perfect. refusing to treat their pain, not that they're refusing to treat their agitation, you're just going to try something else first. And you know that when you call the doctor and ask them, can you have this, they're going to say, what did you try first? So you want to have those answers. So then, how much of communication is not good?
Good job, girl.
90% of the message I'm getting from each of you is your non-verbals right now. Which is why y'all got picked on by that girl, right? Non-verbals can be how close you are. It can be what you're saying with your eyes, posture, what you do with your hands. We're French, so we talk a lot. So we always seem really excited. And then you can see a lot from facial expressions. So we talked about personal space. So I want you to stand up. And if you have someone close, figure out how big your bubble is. So if you were the nurse talking to a patient, how close would you want to get to them? Depends on the patient. If you were the patient, how close would you want them to get to you? Like, how close are you comfortable with someone in your bubble? And that changes depending on your mood. Y'all are hopefully happy and not bored out of your mind right now. So you're like, oh, okay, this is good, right? You're in a good mood. If you were agitated, would you want that close? Oh, no. So knowing where they're at. Okay, guys, let's sit down. Now, personal space is a little bit closer. That's what you'd be doing the talk. They say about two arms length when you're talking to a patient. Social space, when you're all like chit-chatting in a circle, we're about 4 to 12 feet apart, so across the circle sometimes. Public, like if you're at a beach, and somebody, maybe it's a really busy beach, and someone like puts themselves right next to you, it's kind of like, okay, go over there. Especially if there's other room. So it depends on how you're feeling, where you're at, and what the social norms are. What can change the social norms?
I know the time of day sometimes I'm like more worried at night when I'm closer to something than
during the day. I didn't expect that answer, but absolutely. When you're more tired, you're apt to not want something to be close. Culture. Absolutely. There are a lot of cultures where it's not okay to touch somebody. It's not okay to directly look in their eyes. It's respect. And so knowing that and being aware of that. Because what's good for me isn't always good for everybody else. So eye contact. I shouldn't have shown you that, I should have asked you that. When I'm speaking to you guys, which is hard because you're all over the place, so I'm trying to like dart. When I'm speaking, it should be about 60-70% of my eye contact with that person. Because if I'm doing this and talking to you, it's uncomfortable, right? Now, when you're listening to someone, oh, wow, that worked. You got all kinds of eyeball effects. It should be 90% of the time. I mean, you're not staring at them, because that's weird. But it should be 90% of the time, and that's how they know you're listening. And in a classroom, it's hard. Y'all in the back. So I remember sitting in the back going, okay, don't notice me. My seats were over, like, where you guys are, close enough where like I wasn't gonna get picked on in the front row, but far enough back, or far enough that I wasn't gonna get picked on, but close enough that I looked interested. People in the back, they're like, yeah, I'm gonna sit in the back, I'm gonna do my own thing. They won't even notice. Sorry guys, we do notice. Matters in that too. So, what can you take from their eye contact? So, whether they're listening, what else? like everybody has a, like wide eyes and like, oh, uh-huh. You see, you're like, okay, they got it. You can see the light bulb. Is there really a light bulb over their head? No, it's probably their eyes, right? What does it look like when they're unhappy? Squinting, mad, not looking at you. You see a lot of that, What does it look like when they're about to attack? Intense eye contact, possibly. But is it going to be with your eyes? Never. They're not looking at your eyes. They're either looking through you or they're... Right. If someone starts staring at your shoulder intently, they are about to hit you at your shoulder. If they start going looking at your legs and your feet, they're about to do something to your legs and your feet. They look before they act. I don't know if anybody ever played softball. I used to teach t-ball. And I used to tease like, okay, toes, nose, throws. Before they act, they are going to direct themselves to what they're going to do. It's not out of nowhere. So when you get really good at finding that, you can get out of the way. Hopefully we didn't get there, but okay. So they can be sizing you up. Have you ever seen that person you walk in and they're like, okay. You're a big, scary security guard. I'm not going to do anything here. You go to, like, someone, there's a bouncer. You're up, not to do something. They're sizing you up. Can I take you? Okay. So do you, like, make yourself bigger so that they think bigger? That's, like, posturing towards them. They're going to posture towards you. If they're staring, probably intently, if they're looking through you, what does that tell you? Yes. What does that tell you? They're not getting it. They're probably not listening. There's probably something going on in their head. So for people with schizophrenia, if there's a lot of voices and a lot of chaos that they're listening to, they're probably not making eye contact, or they are in it, but they're not seeing you. You can move over this way and they keep staring. There's something going on, and you need. You need to know what else is going on to help them. And people don't sometimes come up and be like, I have auditory hallucinations. Right? No. They're going to do that, and then you say, is there something else that you're hearing right now? Is there something else going on in this room that I'm not aware of? You open them up to that conversation. So knowing what their eyes say, the widening is the good thing. Targeting means they're about to attack. So in all of these, there's no words, you're not talking to this person, you're not hearing her, but you can put a story to every one of them. Because it's all in their facial form. What she's doing with her hands, what she's doing with her face, it's all there. And whether we have it written on our face or not, it's all on our body too. Now, So I want you to pick somebody else in this room. Nobody move, because this is the part where y'all sit up straight and like. I want you to pick someone else in this room. Show me who it is, and then analyze what their posture says. Looking for people. Right next to you? Okay, what does that posture say to you? So not looking at you, clearly not paying attention to you, right? Okay. You know, legs up, kind of like blocked off, right? Anything else that that says? Right? We got this. This is the part where everybody's like, so your posture means something. Even if, like, I was at a presentation and I was freezing, and as much as I know about posture, so hopefully the presenter didn't think I was cold. Or didn't think I was not listening, but rather that I was cold. Your posture means something. So this means what? I'm hearing you, lady, but I'm not listening. If you're cool. So what if, what does it look like to be open? Okay, so not crossed. Yes. Someone just pointed you out as being actively listening. So what about her is active listening? Right. Her ankles are crossed, which is okay. I mean, you don't have to be like, I'm open. But she's not crossing her arms. She's not like this. She's looking. She's got like the thinker pose going. She's, you know, leaning forward. And I can tell you, I don't know, probably no one's watching you, but when I say something, you know that you're listening. You interact and you know they're hearing you. You've got to do that for them. Y'all are good because I don't know your name, so I can't tell. Diane, if you were closed off or open, it doesn't matter so much in the classroom. But with patients who are already vulnerable, yes. Biggest thing we tell people, when you're on clinicals, when you're working with patients, listen, to hear them. Do not be thinking about what your next response is going to be. Because if you're always thinking like, what am I going to say next? I'm going to say something wrong. You don't hear when they say, I'm suicidal, or I'm homicidal, or I'm in trouble, right? They're people. They have wants and feelings. What is the number one reason people get angry in the hospital?
Don't feel hurt.
Don't feel hurt, absolutely. Waiting. And it all comes down to you didn't meet expectations. Whether it's they didn't get the medication they wanted, whether it's that they thought that someone was going to listen to them, and only them, whether they thought someone was going to take care of them right away and didn't. When you don't meet expectations, that's when people get angry. So how do you meet expectations? So you're working med-surg, you're in clinicals, you have clinicals for adult people. So you're in clinicals, you're working with a patient. What does that look like, meeting expectations?
You anticipate their need?
Okay, absolutely. At least meeting them. If you say that you're going to go get them a ginger ale, go get them a ginger ale. Like, do follow through with what you said. Because if they think a ginger ale is coming and the next person walks in their room and no ginger ale, people get angry. And when they're already angry, that's a problem. Even better if you anticipate and meet their needs before they ask. Then you've exceeded expectations and you're good.
Would that be something like, is there anything else that you want to hear?
Yes. And even better, I can get you a ginger ale. Give them options. They've probably not frequented the hospital time or a lot, so they don't even know what you have. Do you ever get that, like, you go over to someone's house and like, can I get you a drink? And then you're like, no, I'm okay. Because you have no idea if they have milk, juice, alcoholic beverages, tea, coffee. You don't know what they have, so offer them. Like, I have this, this, and this. Does any of that sound good to you? That's exceeding. Now, you're going to be clear, because some of these people are having a hard time. You want to be very clear. So you're not going to say, we're going to do this, we're going to go to MRI, and then after MRI you're going to see the doctor, and after that you can do this, and after that, too much direction. One direction at a time. Right now we're going to do MRI. This is what to expect. If you've never been to MRI, CT, X-ray, that's scary. Let them know what to expect. Now if they're saying, no, I'm not going there. I'm not doing this, I'm not going to. It's like kids, right? I don't want to get dressed. So what do you tell kids? How do you get a kid dressed if they don't want to?
Shirt?
Sure. We take the photo away. Good call. Who said the shirts?
The offered choices.
Yes. So, hey, do you want to wear the red shirt or the blue shirt? Either way, you win, right? pressure. In the hospital, do you want, would you prefer to stay in your room or go to the family room for a while? Either way you win, they're staying in the hospital, but you're offering them a choice, so they're in control. Because the whole thing is they feel out of control, right? And follow up on the promises. This is my favorite one. Commandment number 9, do not argue. So arguing is just negativity, right? You don't get anything done from arguing. Are you really going to convince them that they have schizophrenia and they need to take their medication? Not with logic, right? So if they say something, agree to disagree. That's okay. You're not giving, you're acknowledging that they don't agree with you. It's good. Dementia patients, if they say it's been, try that again. If they say it's been a month. If they say it's been a month, and it's really been 6 months, why argue? What does it matter? Why, if you've done clinicals in the nursing home or with elderly people, that doesn't make a difference whether it's been 1 or 6. So just why?
The one that I worked with is basically he was getting married that day. And our usual answer is, oh no, we don't do weddings on Monday, it's weddings on Saturday.
Sure.
And it's Saturday, we're getting married today? No, it's next Saturday.
Yep, deflect, deflect. Because if you get into an argument with them and say, you can't get married, you're already married, and your wife's too much, right? Same thing with people who are in that vulnerable place. Now, do not enter a power struggle. So what do you know about borderline personality disorder? What's that?
Manipulation.
They are probably some of the most difficult patients to work with. Not because they mean to be. Because they have seen some terrible things in their life. Bad things have happened to them, and they have seen much worse than people. And you have to remember that. But it is all about a power struggle. So if they enter into a situation where I'm going to do this or else, and you, so patient comes up with their comb, and they say, I'm going to cut myself. I'm so angry with you right now, I'm going to cut myself. What do you do? Do you grab them and take the comb?
Yes, the
right. So you're not going to grab them and take the comb because you're going to get hurt in that, right? The comb's going to go flying, the shiv, but it doesn't actually happen. So how do you answer that? Do you tell them, no, don't do that? Because when you start giving them a reaction, they're going to try to get more and more of them. That's like bullies, right? They pick on the ones that they get a reaction out of and they keep going until they stop. So you calmly approach them and say, let's talk about this. So what brought you to this place? Why do you feel like doing that? Like, let's put the cone down for a minute and just talk about it. Like, let me know what's going on. Help me understand. If you try to overpower them and you will put that cone down, it's not gonna work. That's when people get hurt. So enter very calmly, reassure them you're gonna work together, keep them safe, and then try to de-escalate. The biggest thing we forget is that after something terrible, what do? We're nurses, right? Someone passes away, you've been working on this case for 11 hours, and that patient passes away. And you were expected to go in the next room for the person next door and pretend like everything's okay. Put the smile on, even though you want to cry. You were expected to be that person. Take a minute. Talk to the people around you. Make sure they're okay. Make sure they're just not stuffing this under the rug. Talk about what happened. Let others feel heard. You can't take it home with you. So you have to get it out at work with your coworkers who understand, right? Because if not, you can't just go home to your friends and be like, you couldn't understand my kind of day today. You can't do that. So give people a chance to talk. Make a point to ask them, how did it go? What were you feeling? How could we have done better? Debriefing always needs to happen. So if we get to the point point of restraint. It escalates the situation, right? Because no one wants to be held or pushed in a certain direction or dragged somewhere. They don't want to do that. They're scared of that. If they're restrained, it means they stay longer, because then you have to get them back to wine treatment and all of that thing, those things. And that's when people get hurt, because then that's, you know, out of fear, they start flailing and hit somebody in the nose and someone's going to hurt them, right? Now, I say all these terrible things. I've been working in psych for 10 years. It doesn't happen like that. More often than not, it is a calm day where you're chit-chatting with a person, you're watching a movie together, you're playing a game, you're doing some groups, you're just meeting them where they're at. So for those that are interested in psych, I promise you it's not like that every day. We want to avoid chemical restraints if we can, right? Because no one likes to give injections, unless there's someone in this room that does. And you really don't like to do that when you're up against, like, I have to do this right now. It's a scary thing. So why? It's not just me saying it works. There's actual data, for those that like statistics, that in an ER, the seclusions and restraints decreased by 43% when they started following those 10 commandments. The injury to staff decreased by 58%. That's pretty big. Just by doing what we thought was kind of common sense, but reminding ourselves that it's common sense, you know, that that's how we should treat people in a vulnerable place. You all look, hey, I feel a little eye contact in your eye. Any questions about how to manage a situation, how to deal with things, how to use all your good questions on the off the issue. All right.